Great to see you here this morning. My name is Mr. Nancy Hanna. She arrived last night for good. Those of you who don't have any idea what I'm talking about, just ask somebody around you. It's great to have you here. Again, my name's Jeff Hanna, the associate pastor. If you're watching on the web, we're excited that you're visiting us. We love to see you where, all over the country where people listen and watch our service. If you're a visitor, we'd love to have you fill out the flap. The flap's a card that's in your seat in front of you. And if you would fill that out and you're a first-time visitor, take it out to the Welcome Center. We have a nice gift for you just as a way of showing that we appreciate you chose Cornerstone this Sunday. We have a lot going on in the church. Certainly, we want to remind you of the announcement loop and your bulletin. Those are the best two ways to get information, or stop out by the Welcome Center if you need more details. They can help you with that. As we do, and things are getting better, we'd again ask that you silence your cell phones. If you need to get up and walk around, that's okay, but maybe sit near the exit so you don't have to interrupt the others around you. And I realize we've had a flawed announcement. We've been telling people the crying room is back in the back. That's really just for babies, okay? If you're just going to cry, there's only so much room in there. So if you're going to just cry on your own and you're an adult, stay in this room if you would. Today is the ClearBlue Anniversary Celebration Day. It's great. Pastor Brenda and Jessica and Jean are all back and have great stories to tell and some memories they'd love to share with you. We're going to hear more about that. They were in Malawi, and it's just amazing all the things that are going on there. So Della Casto is doing what she did last year. She is riding her bike. Hey, Della, can you hear me? No, she can't. It was a video from earlier. She can't hear it, anything. But she's running 23 miles from Orville, and she will probably be here in about the next 20, 25 minutes. And that's pretty cool. It's not too late. If you want to sponsor Della, just jump out. Well, wait till I'm done. But so sponsor her at the Welcome Center or even after the fact. She'd love to have that. And Chris Brown, see, he's trying to keep up with her on his bike. He's doing okay there. They just started, though. We heard they're about 6 miles apart now. Della's in the lead. So anyway, again, we'll be excited to welcome her among us here during this service. So it's great to have you here with us. Let's stand up and say to somebody around you, it's great to see you today.
Let's continue worshiping this morning. Yeah. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for being our healer. You are so good to us in every way. You give us life, you give us breath, you give us hope. You alone are God, and we praise you this morning. Lord, today we ask you to clear our hearts and clear our minds. We need to hear from you today. We're focusing on losing self-centeredness and gaining a heart of generosity. You tell us in your word that where our treasure is where our heart is. It's where our focus and our attention is. It's where our mind is set. Help us to be honest with ourselves and to examine where our treasure is. Is it going to further your name and your purpose? Or is it going simply to us? Let us as Christians be known for our generosity. Let us be known for how we give and how we support you and your cause throughout the world. We want to model you and your selflessness. The world is hungry, hurting, and dying, and we can do something about it. We have to do something about it. We claim your name, we have to do something. Because it is possible to give without loving God, but it is impossible to love God without giving. We have to remember that. Thank you for giving to us so graciously. Let us reciprocate that today and every day. We love you, Lord. We ask all this in your name. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, good morning. Thank you so much for your prayers for us while we were in Malawi. They were much felt and much needed. And we're delighted to be back and get to share with you. Thank you. Thank you. I'm looking for Jessica. Jessica Young, would you stand up over here? Jessica Young went, and Jean Potter, who was in the first service, went. That's my daughter-in-law and my sister. And Jessica went as photographer. She runs camera here at the church, and she got us some excellent shots. It was wonderful. And the reason I'm pointing out to you who they are is I hope that you will grab them, make it a point to grab them at some point in time, and just ask them one question. Let them give you 2 minutes of what God did for them there. It'll change you too just to hear about it. It's really great. Thank you, Jessica. Thank you so much. Now, ClearBlue is an organization that started here at our church after a sermon that I preached in 2006. I had felt God led me to speak about the need for water around the world, and as a result of that, we started raising money for wells, and it spread. It just spread and spread and spread, and we've got lots of people helping us now all around the nation, and we got some people from France that are helping, and we got our first international gift from Korea after Sunhee and I were able to tell them about what was going on with ClearBlue. But the reason that Malawi is important to us is because it's the site of our first well. It's the very first place that we put a well. And since then, we've done about 40 deep water wells there. And the missionary there, it's incredible. You just have no idea. I wish you could all be there and see the difference that it makes. But the missionary there has been very, very intent on everybody finding out that these are believers in Jesus Christ from the United States that are doing this, that they realize there's a pattern, that it's not just a random thing. And so the government became very grateful about this, and they invited me to come, and the two ladies that went with me went to be prayer support and to help us bring home good news to you from what went on there. So we went, they had a celebration day, and we got to participate in that. It was an incredible event, great, great event. And Jessica got some super pictures. We're going to show some of those to you in just a minute. I believe Della has just about arrived here. I want to make sure, is she here? Okay, wait. 10? Okay, all right, we'll catch her. I know she's going to be gasping as she comes in. So anyways, Della's doing that run, and I'll try to catch her when she comes in. Okay, let me tell you about what happened. On this celebration day, They had, the president was out of the country, but there were two members of the president's cabinet that came to that day. Now, I want to tell you what a incredible trip it was for even them to get there. All right? The place, it was at the site of our latest well, which actually ties into a gravity system. And so that place in the mountains feeds four different taps. So there's four different communities that are being able to be served from this one thing. So it was really great, and they were having a ribbon-cutting ceremony and the whole deal. So to get there, it's so far back in the woods. If you've been off-roading, let me tell you haven't done anything quite like this. If you see the bruises, I've got bruises all over me, and it's from getting knocked around, you know, as we were driving, and the roads were not roads. But we went as far as so-called road could take us, and then we had to get out and walk about a mile and a half or 2 miles further to get to the site where this celebration was going to be. And Rachel told you some about that last week, about how excited everybody was. So we had to go up in there, and then after part of the service and the celebration took place, then we had to walk further up into the mountains and then down into this little ravine where the gravity system was. So it was quite an experience, and these guys really, they had quite a trip to get there to the site of the celebration as well. One of them said he was the minister of I believe it was transportation and health. It was kind of a weird combo there, but he said he was a person. Now, most of the people there don't have any idea what it's like in the United States. They don't even have the faintest conception of what it would be like here. But he did, because of his exposure to travel and all of that. And he turned and he said to us as we were sitting there, and he could speak English, he said, "You folks in America have so many options for spending your money, and we find it remarkable that you chose to send some of it here." When I came back, honestly, and Jess and Jean will tell you the same thing, when we were in the mall, it was just such an overwhelming experience, the mall setting, you know, of the airport. Coming back, where you landed in Washington, D.C., and you're walking around there, and everything is so clean, and there's everything everywhere, and all this kind of stuff. And I looked at the resources that we have, and I found it remarkable we don't do more. You know, it's just amazing, given what we have. Now, Benjamin was a member of parliament, and he was a very classy, very godly man who, he came to our service on Sunday. He just came in, and he was talking to us, and I want to read to you. I wrote down exactly what he said because it was so profound to me. He said, "Listen, the gap between what we have and what we need is totally incompatible. In every assessment we do in every village, the greatest need is clean, safe water. We call a borehole a luxury because so few have it." And then he went on. I asked him about the specific needs there. What did they need? Now, I want you to listen here. This is the Malawi government is not a corrupt government. You know, sometimes people will say, "Well, we can't give anything to this country or whatever because, you know, the government is corrupt. They keep the money or they rip it off at the airport or that kind of stuff." That's not happening here. This is a poor country. The leadership is not corrupt. Does the leadership have things nicer than the common people? Of course they do, but they're not living opulent lifestyles at the expense of the poor. The fact is, it's just a very poor country, very, very poor country. And he said, "Let me tell you about the need." He said, "The need in my district alone, just my district alone," he said, "I need 100 wells immediately." And he said, "That's bare minimum." Now see, what they really need to do, they need a well for every 250 people. That's the international standard, a well for every 250 people. But they're trying to get a well for every 800 to 1,000 people. And he said, I need 100 right away. But he said, "My nation is so poor that they've been able to budget." He said, "Over the next 4 years, they're going to be able to give me 12. Can you imagine? That's what it's like there. Now, Jessica and I gave Barry Kane some pictures to do a video for a song that Barb Zalak's going to sing for us in a minute. And he said, when he looked at the pictures, he said, "Wow, you know, amazing pictures. And what an amazingly young culture they have over there." He said, "You know, everybody's so young." He said, "I didn't see any old people." And I said, "Barry, you know why? Because the life expectancy is 37. 37. 37. Our middle son, who I consider to be a young man not even close to his prime yet, would have 10 years if he's fortunate. 37. There's a long, long street in the city, and it's called Coffin Row. And the reason why is because every little tiny square foot holds a place that makes handmade coffins for the people who die. We consider ourselves to be unbelievably struck with tragedy if we have three or four people that we're fairly close to that die in a year. Do you know what they have? They have an average of 3 to 4 family members or close friends die a month for every single person. And almost all of the deaths can be traced to the lack of clean, pure water. Wow. Wow. So let me start this morning by asking you a very simple question. What about the children? What about the children? What about the children? What about the children here in the United States? Are we really, really content to have our children growing up being self-focused, self-centered, always wanting more, having to have another new brand of shoes just because it's new? Another toy, another entertainment center? Are we really content for the children in the most privileged nation of people that ever lived? Are we really content for them to focus simply on themselves? Or do we want them to learn by our example and by our words that the incredible resources God has given us are a gift to share with the world? And what about those children? What about them? What about the children? Can you look into their eyes and say by your lack of action, it's really okay for me, for you to not have a future? What about the children? About What about the children? Wow. In a world that had a similar huge gap between the haves and the have-nots, Paul wrote on behalf of God in the book of 1 Timothy, this is what he said. Godliness with contentment is great gain, for we brought nothing into the world and we can take nothing out of it. That's hard to remember, isn't it? Because we're all stockpiling things and building things up as if we got to take it with us. You know, it seems like that's a tendency of the world. We brought nothing into the world. We can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. Wow. Those who want to get rich fall into a temptation and a trap and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. All you have to do is read the newspaper, you know, watch TV, or probably run a memory check back of your friends over the years. You can think of lots of people who, because they wanted things, got into ruin and destruction, right? We can all think of that. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Some people, eager for money, have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. Now, keep in mind, it's the love of money. That's the root of all evil. Money is morally neutral. It's morally neutral. You know, money is like a brick. You can build a house with a brick, or you can throw a brick through a window and destroy a house, right? It just depends on the person using it. Keep in mind, God has not said that money is evil. It says the love of money is the root of all evil. And as you read those verses, you can see a clear progression. First of all, the love of money. Love of money. You say, well, I don't love money. I mean, I'm not attached to those coins and the pieces of paper. No, unless you're Scrooge McDuck. You know, you don't get really attached to the paper and the coins. That's not the thing. What are you attached to? You and I, we all have a temptation to love money. And what we mean by that, what the Word of God means by that, is we get attached to the things and to the experience it provides. And so we want those things. We want the things we can purchase with it. We want the places we can go with it. And so we get attached to money. We get attached to money, and it leads us into all kinds of evil, like loving things and using people, right? Isn't that easy to do? Love things and use people. We can get into a place where, wow, you know, if somebody puts a scratch on our car, if we get a scratch on our car, man, we are ready to take that person out, right? When that car is going to end up in a rust heap anyways. And the people, please tell me what you're trying to tell me.
No.
Okay. Just speak it. Okay. We can throw away the baby with the bathwater. We got to be careful. We can't afford to love things and use people. Okay, Della, let's get you in here, kid. Maybe she's not here. They've been telling me she's close for the last 15 minutes. She's in sight.
She's in the driveway.
Okay, I'll tell you what let's do. Just for fun, let's go Della, Della. Let's keep doing it, okay? Della, 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 Della. Hey, let's shake it up and make it a little confusing. Let's go Della, clear blue, 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 Della, clear blue. Woo! All righty. That's incredible, girl. Wow. Wow. 23 miles. 23 miles. Is that incredible? You can be seated. Thank you. That's amazing. Chris, come on up. This is amazing. If you're watching by the web, this is a girl who is not a marathon runner, but she runs a marathon 2 years in a row for Clear Blue. And this guy, did you have any trouble keeping up with her? He's on his bike. This is Chris Brown, and he did this, and we love you guys. We appreciate you so much. And Della talked nice and loud into my microphone right here. Why'd you do this?
To save lives for clean water. You know, you can't have the little kids die.
She didn't see the video, but we can't have the little kids die. Thank you. Why'd you do it, Chris?
Just to share with what she was saying there. For the ones that don't know Della, she fell off a truck at work about 2 weeks ago and hurt her hip, and she's already got a bad hip. So she's strong, and she persevered and pushed through this, and I'm just so proud of her.
That's awesome.
And, you know, she's...
Awesome. Yeah. Awesome. Awesome. Thank you. Thank you. And now the words you've been longing to hear. You may be seated. Okay. Thank you. Thank you. All right, let's get back to the Word of God here. The love of money, that's loving the things and the experiences that money can provide, leads us to the great divide. And what's that great divide? It's poverty. Poverty is the great divide. It's the thing that divides the people, the haves from the have-nots. See, when I have a love of money, I'm attached to the things that it provides and the experiences I can get. I can never have enough. Have you noticed that in yourself? You know, you think, okay, you think if I could make $10 an hour, that'd be great, and then I need to make $11 an hour and $12 an hour, right? And it just keeps going. And your kids, don't you notice it quickly in your kids? Yeah, there's never enough. So here's the thing. When we get attached to money, to the things it provides and to the experiences it provides, when we do that, it makes sharing at a deep level almost impossible. Because what happens is, I'm willing to share as long as it doesn't deplete my supply at all, right? It makes the division between us really big. It's not that I don't want other people to have things. I just don't want them to have things if it comes from me. Now again, watch it with our kids. If you've had a child, you know how this is. If you have a couple of kids, you know, if one of them's got French fries and the other one doesn't, it's not really that they want their brother not to have French fries. If you'll give them your French fries, they're happy for it. But if it means they have to have my French fries, I don't think so. And that's hard for us to grow out of, isn't it? It's really, really hard. I'm happy for you to have. I'm happy for them to have, as long as it doesn't come out of my pile. See, that's what the love of money does, and it leaves this great divide between the people who have and the people that don't have. And so when we have that focus, when there's a focus in a culture of the love of money, then the haves get more and the have-nots get less. The smallest, the weakest, the unprotected get less and less. And what happens there? The Bible tells us it leads to all kinds of evil. All kinds of evil. Let's look at the people that evil affects and the people that do evil things because of poverty. Let's first of all look at poor people. Poor people, people in poverty, here and there. What kind of evil comes from poor people? Well, you know what? If you've been poor for very long, and I'm talking poor, you know that you can consider doing some pretty incredible things to get money. Yeah. I heard after first service, a couple of people asked me to pray for them because they said, I'm one of the poor people you're talking about, and I've done some things I'm not proud of to get money to supply needs. See, we can look at people here and over there with judgmental eyes, and we can say, I can't believe that girl would do that for money. I can't believe that man would do that for money. Do you know for sure what you would do if you were in that position? We're not talking about luxuries. We're talking about simple needs. If you had to watch your child lay there sick because you couldn't buy medicine for them, might you do something? Yeah. Yeah, it's easy to judge people when we're not in their circumstances. Wow, people in poverty can get into all kinds of evil because they just simply don't have enough. And then there's another effect. It's when the love of money gets into our hearts, it can affect us because one kind of evil it leads us into is scheming to get more. You know, I want stuff, and so one of the evils that I can get into is trying to figure out some illegitimate ways to get more. That's why you hear of the shipments that, you know, at ship docks and stuff like that, that get ripped off in other countries because people are figuring out, I want things, and how can I get more? Well, I can steal them from this cargo that came in. I can do that. That's where you get corrupt governments here and there. You know, is because people are figuring out, okay, I've got this, but now I want more, and how can I get it? Well, corruption. And that happens in the States too, right? Yeah, we have, that's a hearty amen. We have corrupt governments. We do that. And why is it? Because we scheme to get more. How about this one? Has anybody here ever gotten ticked off by this? This really gets me aggravated. When, you know, there's just a thought that something may go wrong in the Middle East. And so before the newspapers are hardly printed, the prices at the gas station go up. And they haven't even had to pay an increased dime for that oil yet. But they're already tacking it on to us. Is that corruption? Absolutely it is. And what is it? It's scheming to get more. It's figuring out how I can get more because of the love of money. Price gouging. How about the slave trade? The slave trade. That's all kinds of evil. It comes from people wanting more. You say slave trade, yeah, they have it in Malawi. Absolutely. Guess what? They have it in the United States too. If you didn't hear about the sex slave trade that happens surrounding the Super Bowl right here in the United States and happens every year, you had your head in the sand somewhere. That's right. Make sure you're here on June 26th for Freedom Day. We're going to talk about it. The things that go on right here even in Summit County because people are greedy for more and the things, the abuses that they're willing to do to people to scheme for more. Now, those are evils that you and I are not going to participate in, probably. You know, we're not going to do either one of those. But how about the evil that we're familiar with and comfortable with? It's the evil of simply not sharing and hoarding, storing up for myself, living in fear of what giving to someone else will cost me. You know, the famous story of the Good Samaritan. It's really funny. Jesus told this story, and only one person in the story did he call good. Now, all of the guys technically in the story were good men. The one guy, the guy that was going on the trip, he gets attacked by robbers and thieves. They beat him up, they strip him of everything, and they leave him laying there on the road. Okay, three guys come, and they see him laying there on the road. Two of these guys are religious leaders, preachers, pastors, Sunday school teachers. They're religious leaders, and they're good people. They don't murder, they don't kill, they don't do anything bad like that. But they come by, they see him laying there, and they know if they make eye contact with him, they know if they get up too close to his knee, they're going to be expected to do something. So Jesus tells a story, and he says they cross by on the other side. They don't do anything bad, they just don't do anything good. And they leave him there. So Jesus doesn't call them good. The one that he calls good is the one, the Samaritan, the guy who's very different than him. He comes by, he sees the man, he gets up close to him, and he meets his need. He's the only one Jesus called good. And why did he call him good? Because he acted with the heart of Christ. The other two weighed the cost that it was going to be to them to make a difference. It was going to cost them in time, it was going to cost them in energy, it was going to cost them financially, and they said, I don't think so. That's too much. See, that's the evil that we're familiar with, right? Just avoiding it because we don't want to pay that price. And the one that I'm most prey to, when I sin in this way, here's my personal favorite, okay? It's the evil of illusion. The evil of illusion, telling myself a lie. You know, when you go to the dollar store, if you go to one of the dollar stores around here, it's very common for you to be asked to put in your change. Would you like to give your change for the literacy fund or to buy a toy for an AmVet drive or something like that? And I've been in line hundreds of times and had people in front of me, and I've heard the thing they say, and it's the thing I'm often tempted to say. You know what it is? Would you like to do this? And what do we say? Not today. Not today. Not today. There's nothing wrong with saying no. There's nothing wrong with not doing it. And if you're saying not today and you honestly, truly are going to do it another day, then that's not a lie. But isn't that what we do so much with our good intentions? We tell ourselves, I'm going to do something wonderful one of these days. Just not today, right? And the first person, the only person most of the time that believes our lie is us. We put it off. And the reality is that for many of us, true compassion, something that calls for a sacrifice from us, is not even on our radar, ever. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. We're not going to make a sacrificial gift today or tomorrow or ever because we're never going to have our own needs met first. Now, the truth is, in this very room today, there are quite a number of people right here who could pay for an entire well. Our average wells, the ones in India, start at $1,500. It depends on the location and where you are and the difficulty of the well, the amount of casing. But the wells in India are $1,500, and the wells in Malawi are $7,500. But there are many people, in this room right here, who could pay for an entire well, and it would not affect your retirement. You would still have food to eat every day. You would still drive a nice car, and you'd be able to put gas in it. It wouldn't affect your life in any way other than lower your bank account or make you progress towards a goal you have just a little bit more slowly. There are other people who couldn't today write a check for that amount. You couldn't do that, or you couldn't pay for a whole well. But you and your family, or you and several friends could go together, and you could decide that we're not going to eat out so often. We're going to take a couple of meals that we eat out a month, and we're going to put that money towards it. And in the course of a year, you could pay off a well. You could do it as a group. And the truth is, every single person in this room could do something. The youngest one, the oldest one, everyone could do something. Do you know that if you gave $25 a month, $25 a month, you would pay for clean, safe water for a family of five for a month? Don't tell me you can't do that. Your whole family could go together and do $25 a month. You know you spend that on newspapers and magazines and Coke and cigarettes. We could do it. It's a question of want to. These facts, here's the thing that breaks my heart. These facts are shared over and over and over again, and yet the world remains in crushing need. The Church of Jesus Christ could change the world. We could. The United States could change the world. We could. These facts are told over and over and over again, yet it remains a crushing need around the world. The gap is huge between the haves and the have-nots. Is there any way to close the gap? Yes, there is. And do you know how you close it? You start with living water. Living water, Jesus Christ, the living water, transforms the root of the heart. And what is that? The love of money is the root of all evil. Yeah, the love of money. Jesus Christ called himself the living water. He told the woman who came to see him at the well, she was thirsty in a bazillion ways. And this is what he said to her. He said, listen, when you really connect with me, when you really draw deep from me, when you drink from me, I will satisfy your thirst. I will satisfy your thirst for things. I will satisfy your thirst for experiences. I will satisfy you if you really drink deeply from me. And that's the truth, my friends. Listen, if you are hooked on things, if you have to have things to be happy, if you're always wanting more, if you're always after an experience, if you always got to be hyped up, it's a real clue, my friend. You have not drunk very deeply from the living water. Because he takes care of that thirst. You don't have to have more and more to be okay. You don't have to have it. And I'm not saying you're not saved. Here's what I'm telling you is you are far less than Jesus Christ wants you to be. He satisfies the thirst. Now listen, when he satisfies our thirst, our drive for more and more is quenched. Our drive for self-protection is replaced with a drive to love and protect others. And so we want to give. The root of all evil, that love of money, is gone. And it's replaced with love of God and love of people. Okay, so that's the first step in transformation. What's the second one? Listen, clean water can transform the opportunities. It really can. Clean water can transform the opportunities for people. I wish that we had time to tell you this morning. Again, make sure you catch up with me or Jessica or Jean. And let us tell you what a difference water has made in these communities where we are. What a difference it makes. You know what? Safe, clean water shuts the door on malaria, the leading killer. Do you know why? Because the mosquitoes who transmit malaria thrive on dirty water sources. They thrive on that. And they get into the water and it just makes a mess of everything. And the leading cause of death in Malawi is malaria and in most of the third world countries. And guess what? Close second is AIDS. AIDS, and AIDS has a great ability to flourish wherever there is a poor hygiene. Infant health syndrome, the little boy that you saw several pictures of, and the white woman, the missionary, holding a boy in her arms, his name is Chisomo, that name means grace. He's a little boy who was abandoned, a failure to thrive, and the missionaries have just adopted him. And he's very, very tiny and wasn't expected to live. And do you know why? Most of the babies that die from failure to thrive, it's because of lack of water. They just don't have it. And their mothers don't get enough safe, clean water to produce milk. How would you like it if you had to choose between drinking water that would bring disease into your body or not drinking the water and dying from your dehydration? What would you choose? That's the kind of choices that they have. There's a myriad of other diseases that are attacked as proper hygiene becomes available. Listen. The simple act of getting to wash your hands today in clean water becomes something they get to do. Did you know when clean water comes into a community, it's the first time people get to brush their teeth? Can you think of it? Clean water transforms the opportunity. You know what else it does? When water comes, when a well comes to a community, it provides the opportunity for them to have crops. And they can actually, in this land, they have the dry season, the rainy season, and wintertime. And their wintertime is mid-70s. Dream of that, huh? They were wearing jackets. If they had jackets, they were wearing them over there because it was only like 76. So they're freezing. But in that, they can, many crops, they can have two a year, which makes them able to have food for themselves and then food to sell. And then they can do other things. The lady that you saw with the goat in the picture, she's an AIDS widow. Her husband died of AIDS and very, very poor. They're just poor, poor, poor. But the mission there has a program where they're giving goats to women as they can afford them. And these widows keep the goats until they have a kid. And when they have a little baby goat kid, if you're not familiar, that's what a baby goat's called, a kid, okay? Until they have a kid. And when they have that baby goat, then the woman will keep the kid and will give the mother goat to another AIDS widow, and she will get that. And so together they are able to start flocks of goats and have not only meat and milk, but they're able to sell them. It's just amazing. Without water, they can't do that. You know what else clean water does? It transforms time. To get water, they have to walk. The women and children often have to walk for 3 to 4 hours a day to bring water back to the community to meet the needs for that day. And it saves them so much time to have a well right in their community. We're not talking running water like we have. We're just saying having one that's accessible in the community. And so this gives the children time to go to school. Time to go to school. What do you think of a kid who is 5 years old, 6 years old, and they can't go to school because their time is spent in gathering water and doing those things for the family? Now they can get educated and they can work for a future. According to the doctors themselves, if you have to choose between sending water to a community and sending a doctor, send water. Because the water will keep the need for doctors down. How do you know if your heart is truly transformed? Well, you think like Jesus thinks. And so you love people and you use money to meet needs, your needs and the needs of others. You don't see money as yours, but you see it as a responsibility and a privilege given to you. It's God's money and you are stewarding it for Him. Now we have three children, and if you have children, I'm sure you understand this and you're no different than I am. Don't you love it when your kids love each other? Is there anything that breaks your heart more than your kids not loving each other? There's nothing that will hurt a parent. It's a good parent, like your kids not getting along, not loving each other. This is a value that we tried to instill in our kids from their youngest days, and this is it. If you see one of your siblings being attacked by someone else, and you stand back and let it happen, your behind is mine. You are so dead. Because that's what brothers and sisters are for. You take care of each other. And now that they're adults, here's how we feel. If Rachel and Aaron ever find out that Zach and Amanda need help and they won't give it, they will hurt us. They will hurt Charlie and I more than we can tell you. If Zach and Amanda ever find out that JL and Jess need help and they won't give it, that'll be a death blow to our hearts. If JL and Jess find out that Aaron and Rachel need help and they don't help, it will kill us. It's a slap in our face. Nothing hurts a parent like kids who won't love each other and help each other. And our Father is no different. Our Father loves all of His children. And when we have the ability to help our brothers and sisters around the world and here in the States, and we will not, His heart is broken. Jesus Himself said, if you do it for one of the least of these, you have done it for me. If you don't do it, you have ignored me. That's what Jesus said. Jess had an amazing experience over there. On Sunday morning, we were at this one well, and they wanted us to pray and pray a blessing, God's blessing on the well, that it could be used for many years to come to bless people and bring people to Christ and help save lives and all of that. And so because she was a photographer and because they wanted me to pray, we were right up there at the center, and the pumps at the well have a flat top. And so those of us who were close put our hands on the top of the well, and the other people put their hands on our backs so that we could pray together and all of us be united in this. So there's a huge crowd of people there, and we looked down and my first thought was, wow, isn't this beautiful? There were two white hands, and everybody else's hands were black, and it formed this beautiful picture around the well. And I was looking at it, getting ready to pray, and all of a sudden I saw Jess's hand disappear. And I wondered what it was, and I kind of peeked, and I saw she was struggling for composure. And afterwards, she told me what happened to her. Do you know what it was? She said, oh man, it was my left hand. It's my left hand. And when I looked down there, and I saw my engagement ring and my wedding band, and I realized I had more on my finger than the rest of those hands would ever hold in their entire life. She said, I can't even tell you what happened to me. So I can't tell you. Now, what's the point of that? Is there anything to be ashamed of in having a diamond or a wedding band? No. No. Here's the thing. If you have a diamond and a wedding band, if you have a car, if you have a boat, if you have things that are luxuries, you have a real mandate from God to care about people who don't have clean water. You have a mandate from God to care about people who don't have the basic necessities of life. That's what he says. He is our Father, and he cares about our brothers and sisters, his children he loves who don't have what they need. So we need to do something. We need to be truly transformed. We need to do that. The songs we sing are remarkable. They are. How'd you like that one this morning, Burn for You? That was great. I love it. Don't you love that song? Okay. But do you remember what we sang? I'll go anywhere. I'll do anything at any price for you, my King. Okay, let's go back and think about something else for a second. Are we really content to stand before our Father whenever we die? Are we really content to stand before our Father with closets overflowing with clothes and shoes, with a couple of cars in the garage, maybe a bike, a boat, completely stocked shelves, money in the bank, a couple of cell phones in our family, and we're leaving it all here when we die? You remember that part, right? No one brought anything into the world. No one can take it. Are we really ready to stand before God with all of that left behind and look beside us and see a person who came there at 5 years old, 6 years old, 37 years old, who didn't need to because they needed something that we didn't give? You really want to do that? Do you really want to do that? Burn for you. I'll go anywhere. I'll do anything at any price for you, my King. See, when we sing that, most of the time we're lying. We don't mean to lie, but we're talking about the big stuff. What we're thinking is, we think, you know what, God, if you ever ask me to go to Africa, oh, I'll go. I'll go in a minute. Of course, we all know you're not going to ask me because I get heat rash. I'm not going to have to go there. Or, you know what, God, if you ask me to go on national TV, if you would ask me to go on national TV and stand up for you, I promise I would. I would never deny you. Of course, I'm probably never going to get on national TV. You know what I'm saying? Those big things we invent. Yeah, if God asked me to do a big thing, I would do that. Listen, when we sing, I'm burning for you, I'll go anywhere, I'll do anything. When we're saying, where you lead, I'll follow. When we say, who you love, I'll love. We're talking about daily choices. We're talking about writing the check. We're talking about making the sacrifice. We're talking about doing without something we don't have to have so someone else can have a basic necessity. That's what we're talking about. That's what Jesus did. Jesus left everything. Everything. He left a place more beautiful than we can imagine. He left power beyond belief. He left it all for you and me. And when we say, where you go, I'll go. My friends, we're saying something big. It's not casual. You ready to go there? You ready to make some good decisions? You ready to go where Jesus goes, to love where Jesus loves, to love how he loves, and to serve how he serves? I hope so. It's kind of quiet. I hope it'll get rowdy here in a minute. You going to go where he says? You going to go where he goes? Going to serve as he serves? It's not casual. It's a big deal.
All your ways are good. All your ways are sure. I will trust in you. I will trust in you alone.
Trust in you alone.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you.
I pray that you'd help me to mean that with all my heart. I pray you'd help me to mean it this afternoon and in the morning and the next day and the next day and when I write checks and when I plan our budget and whatever I do, Lord, help me to really mean that with my heart, to love like you love and to serve like you serve and to go. Father, I thank you. I just this moment remembered the note that Daddy sent to Gene and Jess and I as he sent us each a little bit of money for this trip. And he said, thank you for going places I can't go. I want to send my money where I can't go. Lord, I pray that you would help me to do that. I pray that you would help us to love like you love and serve like you serve and go like you go until you come back again. Ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for your great attention this morning. Over the next few months, between now and August 1st, I hope that you will do great things for the kingdom of God around the world by your gifts. Right now, I'm going to ask the ushers to come give you an opportunity to give your tithes and gifts that support this local church and our ministries around the world. We can't keep the lights on and keep ministering without you, so we are so grateful for your gifts. And if you're watching by way of the web, we're anxious for you to participate with us as well. So many good things that are going on here at the church. One good thing happens immediately for men right after the service. Right over here in these front rows, Pastor Jeff meets with all the guys who want to, and it's a great blessing if you do, fellas. It keeps you on the front end of spiritual leadership. He's going to give you a little tool and an idea of how you can discuss today's service and the ideas from it with your family or friends that you work with, neighborhood, and it'll help do great things through your spiritual leadership there. And it'll only be 5 minutes. Your family will wait for you. You'll be able to catch up with them very, very quickly. I'm sure you've noticed that the stage has changed, and the reason we're doing this is to serve you better. We're trying to do the things as economically as we can that we would do if we had a new building. And in the weeks to come, it's not finished yet, in the weeks to come, you'll see that we're shifting things around to serve you better. And so be patient with us as those changes take place. Next Saturday is a great event. If you will participate in the Power Ride, that's amazing. It serves people just like we were talking about today, only right here in the States. Information in your worship folder and in the loop afterwards. Next Sunday is Father's Day. What a great time we're going to have. Be sure to get a couple of those cards that advertise the Father's Day event and spread them around. Bring some guys with you. It's going to be a great day. Chainsaw cutting, what do you think of that? Free picnic after the second service, and drawings for some great prizes and games, things that fathers and kids can build together. It's all different kinds of cool things. So we need you to be here. Bring men with you for next Sunday. It's going to be a really, really great day. And now, before you go, I want to say one more thing. All right? It's always much easier to take an offering when people are crying. That's why they do that on TV, you know? That's why they show you those pet commercials, you know, the abused animals, and they play these songs, and you're just crying, and you want to write a check to, you know, prevention of cruelty for animals right away, okay? Here's the thing. Transformation doesn't come by feeling guilty. You have to make a proactive choice. So that's why I didn't take a clear blue offering when you were all feeling gooey. All right? Here's what I'd like you to do. I'd like you to make a gift from your heart that cost you something. And here's how you can do it. We're going to take an offering right now. We're going to give an opportunity for you to give a cash gift or a check if you have it. But listen, what I'm going for is not the easy 10 bucks in your pocket. What I'm wanting you to do is think about it. What could you do if you sacrificed? If you had a big yard sale and got rid of some of the stuff you don't need, what could you do by faith between now and August 1st? And I'd like you to take an envelope or a flap from the seat pocket in front of you and write down your name and how much you believe you could give to the needs of clean, safe water around the world by August 1st. Now, here's what you need to know. We're not asking for your address. Nobody's going to call you up or send you a bill or if you don't do that. That's between you and God. What we'd like to know is how much, by faith, you're trusting God to help you provide as you sacrifice, okay? No guilt. It's between you and God. But if you're going to sing Love Like Jesus Loved, here's a chance to do it, okay? So how about you grab those cards and flaps right now or write a check, whatever you're going to do, and ushers, would you come and help us? We're not even going to play any music while they pick up the offering. Totally no emotion. I could tap dance. Would you like that? We could. This is just the sounds of obedience. This is what we want to hear. And we won't make it be just today. You can turn in a pledge or an amount anytime between now and August 1st. We've got people helping us all around the nation now, but the needs are so great, we could all give huge gifts and it wouldn't take care of the needs. So this is what Cornerstone will do. Another thing you might want to know, we're going to have a work team go to Malawi next June, and it'll be a great experience if you're interested in being on that work team and earning your money to go. Gene Potter will be the person to talk to, and there'll be lots of information coming about that soon. We have other work trips going, different places, so there'll be lots of information about those. All right, you guys feeling good? You guys feeling good? Okay, I'm telling you, you know, there's nothing to make you feel better than obedience. So you do something wonderful and you listen to God and He does great, great things. Okay, would you stand with me, please, and receive the blessing of the Lord? May Jesus Christ, the living water, quench your thirst and help you splash on other people every day until that great day all nations are together at His throne. Amen.